Well, it's good to be with you today, and I just want you to be encouraged. How amazing is God that we can worship the Lord, you know, no matter where we're at. And we want to welcome you today. You might be watching on your phone or on your iPad. You might be hopefully not driving while you're watching for sure, but in your house today. While we aren't together physically, we for sure are together in spirit. And so I just want to say, man, what an awesome time of worship. Thank you guys for leading us today. Wasn't that awesome? That was good. And I know you're clapping right now in your own home or, like I said, wherever you're at. But be encouraged today. Be encouraged. God is good. You know, 7 days ago, like what, seriously, what a difference 7 days makes. We have shifted super quickly from inconvenience to disruption. But listen, I want to, someone has sent me this, actually Josh Serrano, one of our pastors, sent this to me, and it's just so good. It's great. I know you'll love this. Church, while we're interrupted and while we are disrupted, church will not be canceled, worship will not be canceled, God's word will not be canceled, relationships will not be canceled, friendships will not be canceled, conversations will not be canceled, faith will not be canceled, hope will not be canceled, love will not be canceled, Jesus will not be canceled. I just remember that today. Take great courage in the Lord. While things look so differently than what we could have ever expected, God is faithful and God is with you today. You know, no doubt we are disrupted. We are disrupted. I would call this a mega disruption. And in fact, Angela Merkel from Germany said this is the biggest disruption globally since World War II. And then Alan Dershowitz, a famed legal scholar, said for us as a country, it's the biggest disruption since the Civil War. And so, you know, the word disruption's floating around a lot, so I thought we would define it today. Disruption is a disturbance or a problem that interrupts an event, activity, or process. So this is the Webster-Merriam definition of disruption: a disturbance or problem that interrupts an event, activity, or process. Now look, you see dot, 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 it says or life. I added that because it's not just like a minor disruption that we're dealing with. Our whole lives have been disrupted. And you know, I think disruption really does define our needs. When we go through times of disruption, our needs are defined. I was listening today to a doctor from Italy, and you know, they got their hands full in Italy. Things are really difficult. And this doctor, you know, my heart just went out to him. He was so fatigued. And, you know, he was talking about how in the normal course of life, he himself is used to dealing with crisis and making difficult decisions. And, you know, with the gift and the skill that he has and the education, he's able to step into difficult circumstances and really bring healing and really bring hope to people. But as he was talking, like, you could feel the fatigue in this guy's life. And, you know, you could sense that he himself had hit a limit. And he said something that I thought was so fascinating, and it is where we're at. He was talking about how he is accustomed to normally being able to step into hard situations and supply the help that people need. But he said this: in this situation, we need more. In this situation, we need more. And, you know, that resonated with me, you know, and I think that it's true. I think that we see globally, that something more is needed. I think that we see nationally, something more is needed. I think that we all feel personally that something more is needed. We are hitting human limitations. And what we really need, listen, you might be in this spot where the disruption has caused you to come to a place where you're thinking through, man, what do I really need right now? And you know, you might be a little panicked about that. You might be fearful about that. For sure, toilet paper is on, you know, the top three of your list. But everyone is sorting out what they really need. And I would just say to you today, it's not what you need, it's who you need. It's not what you need, it's who you need. In fact, disruptions awaken us to our need for God and His presence. Disruptions, like if you get anything out of this, and you know what? God is going to be faithful and He is going to see us through. But it's not just a matter of survival. Like we need, I believe, to make our disruptions work for us. I know that I want to come out of this a different person. I was talking with Rachel today, and You know, as a leader and as a pastor, a lot of times we're working on helping other people and helping them understand what it is that God is speaking to them. I said to Rachel today, I said, babe, we need to spend time ourselves asking God, what is it that He is showing us? What does He want us to learn in this situation? What is He speaking to us? And then in that process, as He is speaking, we want to give Him time and space so that we can hear what He has to say. I think disruptions bring us to that place where we are awakened. You know, we may have been sleeping through this process, but now we're awakened to our need for God and His presence. And this is exactly what we see in Moses' life. Now, we're in Exodus chapter 33, so don't raise your hand if you need a Bible unless someone in your house is going to go to a room and grab you a Bible or hand you their phone. But if you do have a Bible, Exodus chapter 33, verse 13 today. And if you're joining us for the first time, like I said, I want to thank you for being with us. I'm going to read a story about somebody that I'm sure, even if like you don't go to church, and now here you are listening online and you're kind of shocked that you yourself are watching an online church service. And you might be thinking, man, I'm not going to understand anything. I've got no Bible history. I'm going to read a story about a person that I'm sure you're familiar with. His name is Moses. And Moses went through a major disruption. In fact, you know, you probably have heard the story before of Moses being on top of the mountain, getting the Ten Commandments from God. And then as he went to the foot of the mountain, the people had already strayed from God. They had made a golden calf and they were worshiping this golden image. And Moses broke the two tablets, and it was a rough moment. It was a disruptive moment. It was unclear what was going to happen next for Moses and for the people. It seemed, I'm sure, to Moses like the bottom had just fallen out. And not only was that difficult, but then consequently, because of the people's sin, there was a plague that had struck the people, and so super difficult moment. And so the Bible says in verse 13 of chapter 33, the book of Exodus, this is Moses speaking to God. Now therefore I pray, if I have found grace in your sight, show me now your way, that I may know you and that I may find grace in your sight. And consider that this nation is your people. So look, he had a heart to walk with God, but he also wanted God's grace for the children of Israel. Verse 14, this is God's response. And if you have a highlighter or a pen, just encourage you to circle this verse and commit it to memory this week. The Bible says in verse 14, and he said, my presence will go with you, and I will give you rest. Then he said to him, if your presence does not go with us, think about this from Moses' perspective. If your presence does not go with us, do not bring us up from here. For how then will it be known that your people and I have found grace in your sight, except you go with us? So we shall be separate, your people and I, from all the people who are upon the face of the earth. So the Lord said to Moses, I will also do this thing that you have spoken, for you have found grace in my sight, check this out, and I know you by name. Man, that is so good. You should underline that too. It's amazing. Listen, very simply today, three things that we learn from Moses' experience. As the bottom had fallen out, as he was walking through this moment of disruption, as there was a plague that had been spreading through the people, certainly a very difficult time. Number one, we learn from Moses' life that God is the one that we need. God is the one that we need. And let me just personalize that for you today, because I know that you probably feel the pressure of need right now. And so in all of that, let me just crystallize it to the thing really that you need most. You need God. Now, I appreciate the fact that, you know, Moses was at this point in time 80 years old. I mean, this is not his first time around the block. You know, he didn't just fall off the turnip truck. You know, Moses had a lot of experience underneath his belt. He was a man through whom God had worked an amazing history of miracles. He had experienced the supernatural. You know, I'm just saying to you today that there was a lot that Moses could have leaned on that he had done himself. He was, in fact, a leader of leaders. Much of our Western civilization is based off of the leadership of Moses, what God did through Moses' life. You know, he could have looked to himself. This is all I'm saying today. He could have looked to himself. He could have trusted in his past experience. You know, he could have looked to his age or what he had learned as a leader. And you know what I find so fascinating in these verses is that Moses understood that the thing he needed most was God. You know, for himself, for sure, for the people. Look, as a leader, he wanted to be able to bring to the people what the people needed. The people needed God, but he knew he couldn't bring God to the people unless he had God himself. Unless he was walking with the Lord. And this is, you know, this expresses, you know, I'm so thankful for Moses and how unashamed he is to express his personal need for God. You know, Moses here, he expresses his dependence upon God. You know, in a way, he is saying to God, I'm not taking another step. I'm not going up to the promised land. I'm not leading these people. I'm not moving forward. I'm not moving forward because without you, I can't move forward. I can't take another step. You know, I can't do a single thing without you. I may have all of this experience. I may have all of these resources at my fingertips, but really it doesn't matter because God, if I don't have you, I have nothing. I have to have you in this moment. Moses, as experienced as he was completely unashamed to express his desperate need and his total dependence upon God. You know, I want to encourage you today. Sometimes I think that, you know, with the way that we think, sometimes we perceive dependence upon God as a weakness. And it's not a weakness. It is not a weakness. It is a strength. For you to be able to identify your weaknesses and acknowledge that you need God is not showing weakness, it's showing strength. What I appreciate about Moses is that he never outgrew his need for God's presence. In fact, as he walked with God, he grew to need it more. He never outgrew his need for God's presence. He, as he walked with God, understood that he needed God's presence more. Disruptions, I know this is not comfortable, I know it doesn't feel good, but disruptions oftentimes reveal the unreliable things that we have been leaning on. And when we go through the hard times and there's a stripping, you know, there's a peeling away of those things that normally we look to and trust in, and you know, we're so blessed to live in this country. There are so many resources that we have. And then everything comes to a grinding halt, the brake is pulled, and all of a sudden, as those things one by one begin to be stripped away, we understand how temporary they are, how insufficient they are. Not that they're meaningless and not that we're not thankful for them, but at the end of the day, what we discover is the only one that really is worthy of our trust and faith is God. And that is a good thing. Listen today, God is the one that you need. The second thing that I see from Moses' life is, everyone still with me today? Yeah. Okay, amen. Just checking with the crew. The second thing is this, God is always with his people. God is always with his people. Let me just say it to you again. God is always with his people. I feel like I need to say that a couple of times because, you know, when we go through crisis, we feel like God is not with us. We feel, I emphasize the word feel here, we feel like God is not with us, and that is not true. You know, I said this to you, verse 14, such an important verse, and I just want to draw your attention to it again. The Bible says, God is speaking to Moses, my presence, well, how's the rest of that go? Church? Yeah, we'll go with you. My presence will go with you. My presence will go with you. He didn't say, my presence might go with you. He didn't say, hey, if you're a good boy, you know, maybe I'll hang out with you a little bit. He said definitively, he said it as it is a promise. He said it faithfully because, you know, it's impossible for God not to be faithful to us. He said, my presence will go with you. So I want to just declare something to you today, and I want to declare it boldly because it's a fact. It is true. No matter what happens circumstantially in our lives, no matter how we may feel, there has never been a time when God has abandoned his people. There has never been a time. There has never been a time in the history of mankind where God has abandoned his people. You know, David had walked with God for some time, and in Psalm 37:25, he said these words, they're so good. He said, I have been young and now am old. I resonate with that. I say amen to that. And then he goes on to say, yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken, So he's like, man, I'm looking over the course of my life. I've been young, and now I'm an older guy, and, you know, I've got the grays to prove it. And I can tell you one thing is true over the course of my life. I have never seen the righteous forsaken by God. God has never abandoned his people, never. You know, if you're watching our daily devotions, we're going through the gospel according to Mark. And, you know, the other day, it might be coming up, I'm not sure, we've recorded so many, but we were talking about the disciples in the storm as they were heading to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, and Jesus had said it. He said, hey, get in the boat, we're going to the other side, and then you're probably familiar with the story, halfway across the Sea of Galilee, raging storm, wind was blowing, waters were filling the boat, and, you know, disciples are freaking out, straight up panic, total panic. And terror, grown men. And so, you know, Jesus is, you know, you guys know the story, he's sleeping. He's sleeping in the stern of the boat. And so what do? They go to him and they wake him up and they say, don't you care that we're perishing? And there was a lesson for the disciples in this. There were multiple lessons for sure. But one lesson was this. They learned that no matter how bad it got, Jesus was always with them. And if Jesus is with you, everything is going to be okay, right? I mean, this was the admonition from the Lord. You know, why are you so afraid, O ye of little faith? Why are you afraid? You know, you might think, well, why wouldn't they be afraid? And the answer is, they didn't have to be afraid because Jesus was present with them. And so the truth is that that storm could have kept raging. They still would have gotten to the other side. They were safe as long as they were in the presence of the Lord. Now, I love what they did. You know, they were honest with their fear, and they went to him. They woke him up. And I appreciate this about the disciples. Yeah, there was a learning curve for them with respect to faith, but I believe they did do the right thing. They did the right thing in going to the Lord. And so I want to encourage you, in this moment where you're tempted to be filled with fear, do the right thing and go to him. Do the right thing and go to him. Feed your faith. I was talking to Scott Harold from SOS Radio last night. He had just done a podcast with Max Lucado. Max said something so strong. He said, feed your faith and starve your fear. Feed your faith and starve your fear. Look, you really have two options set before you. You can get all consumed with things that will just feed your fear and your panic. And if you do that, it's just going to grow and it'll be like that storm. It'll wipe you out. Or you can choose to walk by faith and trust in the Lord and rely upon his presence and go to him and believe his promises. And as you do that, I'm saying to you today that not only will your faith grow, but your fear will be starved. You will starve out the panic. It will begin to decrease. As you trust in him, he is going to say over your life, over those fears, peace be still. You know, Paul was in an uncomfortable situation in Corinth. Paul was in a moment of disruption. He rolled into Corinth, and, you know, he said it himself. He said, man, when I came into your city, I was afraid. There were false gods worshipped all over the place, and I knew that it was going to be total rejection of the gospel. And in the midst of his fear, what happens? The Lord comes and speaks to him. And Paul relays this in Acts chapter 18, verse 9. This was what Jesus said to Paul when he was afraid. He said, do not be afraid, but speak and do not keep silent. Why? Why? For I am with you, and no one will attack you to hurt you, for I have many people in this city. So the Lord comes to Paul in the midst of his need and says, Paul, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Do what I've called you to do. Speak. Don't insulate. Don't turn inward. Don't just seek self-survival and self-preservation in this moment. I have a commission for you to fulfill, and you can do it. You can fulfill the commission. Why? Because I'm with you. Even if the adversaries mount around you, I'm going to protect you. I'm going to keep you. He has promised to be with his people. In fact, Jesus, as he gives the Great Commission, the final words to his disciples. And you guys know, listen, when final words are spoken, the best is always saved for last. That's just the way it is. And so what did he say in Matthew chapter 28, verse 20? He said, I am with you Yeah, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. So in every circumstance, in every situation, why did he save it for last? I think he saved it for last because he knew his disciples would need it. He knew that there would be disruptions in their life, and they ultimately needed to find their strength in him. So listen, God is the one that you need. God is always present with his people. And finally, today, God's presence gives you what you need. God's presence gives you what you need. And this is the second half of verse 14. So he did say to Moses, my presence will go with you, but not only that, I will give you rest. I will give you rest. Now, I think Moses was really blessed by this. I think Moses was put in a place of peace by this, because not only was God going to be with him, but God was going to supply him with absolutely everything he needed. Man, when you're in a position of leadership and you're the one calling the shots and making decisions that affect, in Moses' case, millions of people, you really need God. You need God. And God says to Moses, not only will I be present with you, but I'm going to give you rest. In other words, I'm going to supply to you, Moses, everything that you need to get the people through this difficult circumstance. Now, they were 2 million people in the middle of the desert. They were going to travel up to, you know, the promised land, but I just want you to think about this. I mean, there are no resources. There is no food. All the shelves were empty. Right? I mean, you think you got toilet paper issues? Think about 2 million people in the middle of the desert. You know, that's, I don't know how that works. You know, I was making a joke the other day with my family. I probably won't say it now because, you know, I mean, if it gets really bad and you're in the forest, at least you got leaves. In the desert, I mean, it's just not good. But think about this. Think about 2 million people and a total dearth and absence of resources. You know, we went into Walmart just to get some food for our dogs, and you walk in, and there's the produce section, and the produce section is just like full. Pineapples and tomatoes and watermelon, and I'm like, welcome to America, you know? We have so much available at our fingertips, it's amazing. They had none of this. None of this. And when God said, I will give you rest, he's saying to Moses, everything you need, I'm going to supply for you. Moses, everything that you need, all that the people need, do you really think that I don't know what the needs of the people are? Jesus was saying to his disciples, you know, consider the lilies of the field. Consider the sparrows. You know, sparrows don't sow, they don't reap. God provides for them. Lilies don't, they don't toil or spin, and yet they are arrayed in greater glory than Solomon himself. We learn to trust in the Lord. Give us this day our daily bread. I will give you rest. I think when he said, I will give you rest to Moses, he was saying to Moses, I'm going to be the one that guides you. I'm going to be the one that guides you. I'm going to lead you in the wilderness. Remember, they had no clue where they were going. They did not have Siri to say, hey, Siri, you know, how do we get to Beersheba? Or there was none of that. They had to be led by the pillar of cloud and the pillar of fire. And so when God says, I'm going to give you rest, he's saying, I'm going to guide you. You may not know the decisions to make, but I will supply the wisdom when you need it. Listen, he'll do the same thing for you. He will do the same thing for you. He will bring you guidance. You know, you're in a spot right now for sure where you have unanswered questions. There's decisions that you need to make. And, you know, there are many of those decisions before you. God is the one who desires to guide you. And I would just want to encourage you today, God does not stop leading you in times of crisis. He leads you more. He leads you on as you lean into him. He will lead you on as you lean into him, as you come to him, as you go to him, as you lift up your request for wisdom, God will supply to you the wisdom that you need to make the decisions that are before you. I believe that he was also saying, you know, to Moses, I'm going to supply the power. I'm going to supply the power. You need strength, right? I mean, it's not an easy journey. You're going to be surrounded by adversaries. For sure, this is an issue of survival. And everything you need to be empowered, everything you need to be protected, Moses, don't worry about the adversaries. There are going to be people who stand against you. I've got that under control. I'm going to be with you and I'm going to give you rest. You just need to know that I'm the one who supplies your power. You need strength. You need strength. And, you know, I think this is so true for us right now as Christians. We don't just need strength to survive. We need strength to shine. We need strength to shine. We need strength to be more than conquerors in Christ Jesus right now. Not just so that we can get through it and you know, have somebody create a shirt, you know, I survived coronavirus with a little image of the, you know, virus. Like, that's not what we're after. Like, we don't want to just get through this. We want God to do something. We want God to do something great. We want God to take this disruption and use it to bring people to faith in Christ. And so you might be thinking today, man, how do I do that? Where do I get the strength for that? I'm already feeling the weakness. I'm already feeling overwhelmed and burdened. And the answer is, you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. Philippians 4:13. He has made available to you everything that you need. All of the power for you to shine in this moment is supplied through the person of Jesus Christ. And the final thing today in this point is when he says, I will give you rest, for sure he means peace. For sure he means peace. He's saying to Moses, you don't have to panic. You don't have to fear. You don't have to be overwhelmed with anxiety. You don't have to be all stressed out. Like, you don't have to give in to discouragement and depression. You know, you don't have to be in this place where these circumstances become a vortex that just suck you down and draw you away from me. He's saying to Moses, you don't have to walk down that road. And neither do the children of Israel, because I'm going to be present with you and I'm going to supply supernatural peace that surpasses all understanding. You guys know that the desire, there is an adversary. There is an adversary of our souls, and the desire he has is to overwhelm us with anxiety and peace and bring us to a place of discouragement and depression. And you know, if this situation goes on, there's going to be a greater temptation towards that, especially as we're fatigued physically or emotionally, maybe even spiritually. Look, if we're not finding our strength in him, we're going to find ourselves overwhelmed with fear and anxiety. The solution to that is the presence of God. In fact, you know, Psalm 23, verse 4, David said this. He said, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. I will fear no evil. Why did he say that? Because he goes on to say, for you are with me. So for David, it was like, you know, even if I'm in that spot where the shadow of death is looming over me, and I am as vulnerable as I could possibly be, Lord, I'm not going to be afraid. I'm not going to be consumed with anxiety or overwhelmed with panic, because God, you are with me. And if you are with me, then everything is going to be okay. So look, I want to say to you today, God is the one that you need. God is always with his people. God's presence gives you what you need. The promise of all of this, you'll see this in Moses' life, and it's so important at the end of verse 17. The promise of all of this comes because God says to Moses, I know you by name. I know you by name. Look, I want to wrap up with this today and say, you know, that from what God says here, we learn that all of these things, the gift of God's presence, the supply for the things that we need, they come through the conduit of real relationship with God. This is what he says. He doesn't say, hey, Moses, because, you know, you have the physical lineage of Abraham, I'm going to do this for you. No, he says, I know you by name. We have a relationship. I've established a relationship with you. And the promises of God come through relationship with him. There are so many promises of God that are amazing. The promise of his presence comes when you put your trust and faith in Jesus Christ. And listen, you know, maybe you've never taken that step of faith. You've never believed in Christ. And here you are, your life has been disrupted. And now you're thinking about the issues of mortality. You know, for you, it is true right now that while there are maybe many things that you need, all of a sudden there's an awareness through this disruption that the thing you really need is not a thing, it's a who, it's God. You know, you're beginning to consider things that you've never considered before because your life is being shaken. And you know, that's exactly what happened in my life before I put my trust and faith in Jesus Christ. My life was shaken. My life was disrupted. Albeit the disruption came because of my own decisions. You know, I've not always been a believer in Jesus Christ. There was a time where I was antagonistic towards Christians. And I felt that they had committed intellectual suicide, and I considered them to be weak people. You know, you weak people need God. Strong people don't need God. Weak people do. And so, you know, as I was living that life, a series of things happened. I ended up in jail, and my life was shaken. And I realized the weak and unreliable things that I had been leaning to and looking to and building my life upon, and how faulty they were. And not only that they were faulty, but they were leading me down this path of self-destruction. And as God had allowed that disruption to come into my life, you know, there were many people in my life, many Christians who had been sharing the love of Jesus Christ with me, it became aware to me in the moment while I was behind bars that I needed God, that I needed to make a decision once and for all, that I needed to stop rejecting God, that I was in a place where I had sinned against God. And, you know, while I was living this life ridiculing Christians, I knew there was sin in my life, and I knew that if there was a God, I deserved his judgment. And it was in that moment of disruption that I recognized that I needed the forgiveness of my sins. And I didn't want to live another minute, another moment without God in my life. And so I put my trust and faith in Jesus Christ. And he forgave me of my sins. He pulled me up out of a very, very dark place. He gave me a calling. He restored my life. He transformed me and changed me. He surrounded me with people that loved me sincerely. He did such an amazing work in my life. He established a relationship between me and the Father simply by faith and trust in him. And so, listen, I want to say to you today that God desires to be present in your life, but his presence comes through faith in his Son. Today, you're watching online, and maybe, you know, this is something you never thought that you would do. I believe God has brought you to this moment so that you can take a step of faith and trust in Jesus Christ, because this is the message of the gospel. God loves you. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that whoever believes in him should not perish, but should have everlasting life. God right now is calling to you through these circumstances. He's calling you to come. He's calling you to look to Jesus. He's calling you to confess and repent of your sin and turn to Christ in faith. And as you believe in the Son of God, you will be restored to God. He'll forgive you, and you know, he'll fill you with his strength. He'll guide you. He'll give you his peace that surpasses all understanding. So listen, if this is you and you're listening right now, I want to lead you in a very simple prayer. It's a very similar to the prayer that I prayed over 20 years ago. It's a prayer that begins your relationship with God. This is the first step that you need to take. And as you take this step, as you repent of your sins, as you believe in Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, his sacrifice and his resurrection, as you choose to follow him as one of his disciples, God's presence will be with you. In fact, not only with you, God himself will dwell in you. He will do these things in your life that are just so amazing. So we're going to close in prayer right now. I'm just going to ask you, wherever you're at, just to bow your head and close your eyes. I want to lead you in a very simple prayer. You've never put your trust and faith in Jesus Christ. This is the moment for you to take this step of faith. And I'm going to lead you in this very simple prayer. In addition to that, listen, for those of you who may be watching right now and you are a Christian, but you know you've been wayward, and these circumstances, kind of like the prodigal son, these circumstances have awakened you to your need for God again. And you need to come home to him. I believe right now the church needs to be awakened. And God desires to do that work in us first. And so as I lead you in this prayer, maybe for you it's not that you've never put your trust and faith in Christ. It's just that you need to come home. You need to come back to your Heavenly Father. So let's pray together. Very simple prayer. Make this your prayer to God. God, today, I give you my life. God, thank you that you have used these circumstances to awaken me to my need for you. Today I'm choosing to trust in Christ. I believe that he died for me and that he rose again, and that through faith in him, you have forgiven me of my sin. You've made me your child. You've given me the gift of everlasting life. And you have promised now to be with me forever, even to the end of the age. Thank you for loving me. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Hey, listen, if you made that decision to follow Christ today, we want to welcome you into the family of God. We're so excited for what God is doing in your life. Amen. It's good. We're happy for you today. And listen, we want to follow up with you. It's really important. You've taken the first and most important step. You have a relationship with God now. You're a child of God. We want to connect with you. And of course, you know, via social distancing, through technology, we want to make sure you have a Bible. We want to get some information from you. We want to be able to talk to you about this step of faith that you have taken. And so we want to encourage you to go to our website, cclasvegas.org/new-believers. So let me just say it one more time. You might be on our website already. cclasvegas.org/new-believers. And there's some information in there that we'd love for you to fill out. Want to get in touch with you. Also want to encourage you that we have pastors that will be available there. Where maybe you have some questions that you need answered, or maybe you have some prayer requests. We want to pray for you. Also, our pastors are available on our social media platforms. We would love to pray for you there as well. We are rolling out this Monday church online. So if you go to our website, kind of like we're going to have a TV guide of daily broadcasts that we would encourage you to participate in and just be fed by. You know, I think sometimes I hear this a lot from people. Hey, Pastor, I'd engage more, but I just don't have time. And now you might have that time. And so we want to really encourage you to engage in the Word of God. There's going to be great programming, very diverse, and so I want to encourage you to consider that. And then, of course, we have our daily devotionals and then our Facebook Connect later on in the day with our pastors. God bless you guys. We're so thankful to have been able to spend this time with you. We pray that God richly blesses you this week, that you not only sense His divine presence in your life, but you see it manifested in signs, miracles, and wonders that God does through your life what only He is able to do. Of all of the things that we need right now, what we do really need is Him. And that is the message we are called to bear to the world today. Go out, fulfill the Great Commission. God bless you guys. We love you. Have a great day.